Hi, everybody.
You're listening to OVFL Live, your radio home for OVFL scores, stories, and interviews with Marshall Ferguson. Hello, Canada. This is episode 6 of OVFL Live. It is Monday, June 30th, 2014. Episode 6 is brought to you by Canada. She's the greatest country in the world. Heck, the history of the world. Too much of the news is about what's wrong with Canada. Well, tonight our top story is what's right with Canada. For starters, we kick butt. Nazi butt. USA hockey team butt. Wimbledon butt. Milos and Genie are both in the quarterfinals in the greatest tennis tournament in the world. So what, Genie had to play some girl who had a fluke win against Serena Williams, but who cares? And our National Football League really kicks butt. The CFL has returned in all of its Western Conference dominating glory, kids, as several blowouts occurred over the weekend. Winnipeg over Toronto, 45-21, kicked off the entire weekend. Then Calgary beat up on Montreal, and Troy Smith looked awful for the Alouettes. Then there was the biggest rain game I think I've seen in the last couple of years when Hamilton traveled into Saskatchewan yesterday evening, and played against the Riders. And the Riders looked as dominant as they did in that Grey Cup victory last November, beating up all over the Ticats. Then Edmonton went into BC and took on the Lions and shut them down pretty hard as well, which was interesting to see because despite Travis Lule being out, I don't think anybody saw that coming with Edmonton just walking in there and kind of going punch for punch with the BC Lions team. But that might be the Chris Jones effect. We don't know yet. It'll be interesting to see how Edmonton does. Regardless, the CFL West looks a lot stronger than the East through week one. And that brings to mind, congratulations to the Ottawa Red Blacks, currently in first place in the CFL's East Division. Congrats. Congrats, Red Blacks. You've worked hard for it. It'll be really fun to watch the Red Blacks play. Why they don't have a game in week one when they're coming back into the league, it's one of those things that bugs me about the CFL. It's a fantastic opportunity to bring a team back into the fold with a marquee matchup on like a Saturday evening for everyone to celebrate the return of the Red Blacks, and they don't even have a game. They could have played on the road for all I care. I understand their stadium might not be ready, but they practiced in their stadium last week. So as you've learned from this show, there are many things about the CFL that I love and about just as many that I just don't understand. Maybe I'm just not smart enough to understand. The top 50 players of the CFL were also voted on by the media, I believe. And that happened last Thursday before the Winnipeg and Toronto kickoff. I thought there were some questionable picks. Media, you know, there might be some egos involved more than anything else. We've seen that in recent Hall of Fame votes. I don't know if some players are so popular with the media, and that might have a bit of a role to play with it. The one that I really didn't like was Kevin Glenn being ranked much lower. I believe it was 10-15 spots lower than Mike Riley. And Kevin Glenn to me is the ultimate passed over, ignored, not given his fair credit in the CFL guy. He's been in the league for so long. He's very high up in all-time passing yards in the Canadian Football League. He's passed over in Winnipeg after he was injured. Then he gets traded to Calgary when Hamilton used him and they tried to replace him with Quinton Porter before that. He goes to Calgary, thinks he's going to be great. They throw Tate in. Now they throw Bo Levi in. That's a different story. He gets sent to Ottawa. And I remember the interview on the expansion draft day. He said, "I'm just so happy to be in Ottawa. I can't wait to be a part of this team. It's going to be a ton of fun." And then they take Henry Burris, and he goes, "So you took me away from a team that I started several games for last year in order to make me a backup on your team?" Which was just the ultimate punch in the face for Kevin Glenn, which, to be fair, he's withstood about 20 haymakers in his playing career from coaches and general managers. So KG lower than Mike Riley I wasn't very happy with, because Mike Riley didn't really do anything last year, in my opinion. But then Edmonton goes into BC and makes me look like an idiot for tweeting out that I disagree with that pick. So I thought that was interesting. Speaking of the Hamilton Tiger Cats as well, the CFL, they struggled in the rain, as I said, against the Riders. Kolaros went down for 11 sacks yesterday in the rain. Obviously, the conditions play a part, but that Hamilton offensive line does not look great. 51 sacks all of last year on Toronto Argonaut quarterbacks when Kolaros was playing for Toronto, and he had 11 yesterday on just himself. So that is interesting to see. It's not exciting times for the offensive line, I'm sure, in their meetings today. That's not going to be a lot of fun. It's not Kolaros' fault completely. There's play calling. It's pouring rain. It's a new offensive line. There's a couple of injuries along there. But Jeremiah Masoli did look real good in the preseason. I think we should free Masoli. I have a feeling that Masoli will get a chance to start a couple of games before this season's all said and done. I want to play for you a real quick interview I did with Jeremiah Masoli of the Hamilton Tiger Cats a couple of weeks ago, just talking about some of the fun intricacies of the Canadian Football League. Hope you enjoy.
About the stadium experience, obviously being at a very small setting compared to what you're used to playing at Oregon. What is it like to play? Obviously, you had training camp here, but to go in a game experience and play in front of such a small crowd up in Canada here.
It was fun, man. The fans were into it. I'm glad they got to come out and cheer us on. I'm glad we put out a victory for them. You know, it's important to get the positive vibes rolling early, especially with the first preseason game.
It's a little bit different than being down at the old Ivor Wynn, obviously, with the bigger crowd. But you're kind of acquainted to the Canadian game by now. I've been here long enough that you understand that there's some unique aspects that surround the Canadian game. Do you enjoy kind of the different Canadian fun aspects that are, you know, they're a little bit quirky, and
right.
People say the Canadian game's a little bit different like that,
right.
But it's a very
unique. It's a great opportunity for myself, first and foremost, and beyond that, it's always good to enjoy and experience something different. You know, I think different experiences help add character to yourself. And I love the way the CFL is, man. Especially our fans. You know, we kind of have our own niche over here, and we're different from the rest of the league. And I like it.
That was Jeremiah Masoli, the currently third string quarterback behind Dan Lefevre of the Hamilton Tiger Cats. If you've never seen the highlights from the 2008 Holiday Bowl of Oklahoma State against Oregon, YouTube them right now. As soon as you're listening to this, I don't mind. You can pause the YouTube podcast, do whatever you got to do. You need to see those highlights, because Jeremiah Masoli, if you're not really sure what he can do, look that game up. I talked to him about that game and just kind of told him before we did the interview. I said, man, I remember watching that game with some of my high school buddies, and I was just going nuts because I had no idea who you were. And then he's one of those guys that popped off the page. He ended up not actually finishing his career at Oregon. I believe he got into some trouble at Oregon, headed off to Ole Miss, played there for a year, and then ended up bouncing around. I believe he got taken by Edmonton, signed with Edmonton, and then traded here. I'm not sure in what deal that was for, but he is in Hamilton now. He just signed a contract extension actually after the end of the preseason, which tells you what the Ticats management thinks of him. Speaking of great quarterbacks, it is time for the OVFL Live.
The OVFL Live Player of the Week.
I am joined on the line by Matt Duffy, the quarterback of the Ottawa Myers Riders varsity team. Matt, how are you?
Not bad, yourself?
Pretty good, man. So another good week for Myers out there. This week you were 19 for 24 for 424 yards and 5 touchdowns. Pretty nice little afternoon for yourself, wasn't it?
Not too bad, not too bad.
Yeah, nice to kind of chip away at them, throw a bunch of short hooks and get 424 yards, because I'm sure that's how it went, right?
Yeah. Went a bit on long lines. We had a couple deep passes and stuff, but the short game was there, and then that opened up the deep game, obviously.
Yeah, and your running game, obviously, has been pretty smooth as well so far this year. You guys really have a solid overall team out there, don't you?
Yes. I like to think that our offense is designed nicely so that whether the passing game's not there, we can go with the run game or vice versa. And it also is designed that it plays along with a bunch of different coverages. There's a lot of different reads off of it, so a lot we can do with it.
Yeah, how would you define your offense? Because I see you guys putting up big numbers each and every week, and you want to talk about spread, pro style, power run, all of those different things. I've seen a couple of video clips of you guys, and it seems like you're just really balanced. Like, how would you kind of define your offense as the quarterback of this team that's being so successful?
I'd probably say it's spread offense. As you first said there, definitely spread offense. We are in a pistol a lot of one back. Basically, it's just a lot of options that we can do with that package.
And are you given a lot of flexibility out of that pistol? Because I know in a lot of the different pistol offenses that you see throughout the NCAA and NFL, the quarterback has a lot of options, because the whole idea to put the running back behind you, which is the only thing that separates the pistol from the shotgun, and everybody gets mind blown whenever somebody says that. What? That's the only difference? Yeah. Well, why is the pistol so amazing? Well, because it allows guys to hit runs downhill, right? And, yep. And a lot of the time, that changes your zone read game because it changes the angles on those DNs that you're trying to read. Are you doing a lot of reading DNs and trying to kind of confuse the defense by hitting those runs downhill as opposed to just the straight old-fashioned hand it off to the guy and hope that he finds his way through the line?
Yeah, we actually, that's on point to what our offense about. Our offensive coordinator, Rob Bento, told me basically behind his offense is basically to disguise the running back.
Yep.
Obviously in the pistol, they're right behind me, so they can't see what the running back's doing. They can't tell his tendencies, if he's leaning left or right. They can't see his eyes, where he's thinking about going. So it basically makes the defense guess. And a lot of our runs, actually most of our runs, depend on what the running back sees. There's not like a straight, you know, 21 dive or 24 dive or anything.
That's, right.
So, like stuff they used to do in Pee Wee would be like, oh, okay, hand the running back and he's going in between this guy and this guy. No.
Yeah, you don't really call holes anymore, do you? You just kind of send a guy in a general direction and hope that it works out for you.
Yeah. We usually call it based on the defensive fronts.
Right.
And basically he makes reads off of that. Our O-line makes reads on the ball. They relay it back to me. I can change the play if I want, or we can change the sides. It really all depends. And then once we give the running back the ball, I mean, he's got many options, either to go up field with the blocks or take a cutback or bounce it outside. There's a lot of stuff you can do.
Yeah, you have 20 passing touchdowns as a team on the year. I'm just looking at some more stats here. Your running game might not rank as highly as your passing game right now, but regardless, it is a nice balance, and you guys are obviously doing something right up there. What do you kind of want to accomplish moving forward? I moved you guys from my number one to my number two in power rankings based on the fact that you might not be playing the same competition that perhaps Essex or Niagara, even Cambridge, is down in the western side of the province. Do you kind of despise the idea that you guys, you know, kind of walk through teams that you just happen to get based on your geography?
Well, that's always been a controversy with the East and West. Of course, in the OVFL. There's a lot of good teams in the West who I think match up fairly against our teams up here. But yes, there's a few teams in the East that don't get as much numbers as our teams do.
Right.
I remember going through Canada Football Chat, one of the forums, and some of the teams that we played.
Ah, the forums.
And, yeah, around Toronto, some people were saying they're only getting maybe 20 to 30 guys out of practice.
Yeah, it's crazy to think about for your team, isn't it, to have that few of guys coming out when you guys have so many all the time?
Yeah, so I think that's one of the big reasons why the East is looked at as weaker, because
right.
there's only a minimum amount of players showing up at every practice, while we get maybe 60 guys every practice. We have our full team out there.
Why do you think that is? What do you think the difference is in the Toronto area and the Ottawa area? Because obviously in Toronto there's so many different things to do, and it might be based on money or geography like we're saying, but there really isn't that much of an excuse for a huge disparity in turnout across the league. Maybe it's how the organization is run. I know Myers is an incredibly well-run from the top-down organization. But why do you think that is, that there's such a difference between teams across the province in terms of interest and their ability to compete with one another?
I mean, it fluctuates over the years. I started in PWOV and then went up through junior and then senior. And, I mean, it wasn't like the same teams were getting very low player turnouts and other teams were getting a lot. I mean, it changed over the years.
Right.
A couple of Toronto teams would get a lot of a lot of players out, and then the next year they wouldn't get any, or a couple times it was like that with a few teams. It just seems that Myers is able to sustain a lot of players to come. Even Cumberland has a lot of players out on their team.
Yeah, that's
consistently, yeah.
That's where I was going with my next question. You jumped the gun on me. How much are you looking forward to week 8 when you play on Saturday, July 12th against the Cumberland Panthers? It is at home for you. It's at Minto Sportsplex, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, so you are at home. You have the advantage of that wonderful AstroTurf that scarred my arm for about 9 months
yeah.
when I played there the one time. How many marks do you have from Minto?
Quite a few. I was actually scratched up more from the Carlton field this past weekend than Minto.
Really? Why is that?
Yeah. No idea.
No idea. Because I played at Carlton too, and I found that field wasn't too bad. I'm not sure why that would scrape you up.
It's nice. It's nice. The turf that they use is different than the carpet at Minto.
Right. You're just used to your home. That's what it is. Yeah. Why did you guys switch over to Carlton? Are you playing games there for the rest of the season, or was it kind of a promotional event?
No, that was just a mutual thing. I don't know the reason behind it.
Yeah, I'm guessing it was probably to get you out there for promotion kind of thing and show one of Ottawa's very best teams, and you guys showed it this past weekend. It is an interesting OVFL season so far. I look forward to seeing you hopefully at a game. Hopefully I get to see you down the road in the playoffs, whether it's crossing over into the Adams Conference for a championship game or whatnot, because I would like to give you a chocolate bar of your choosing should you complete the OVFL Live Price is Right Challenge correctly. Are you ready to play the Price is Right?
Yes.
You are ready to play.
Yeah.
Excellent. I'll throw on my background music here and we will get going. Here's the deal, Matt.
Yeah.
You can throw the pigskin, but can you know the prices of items? There are going to be three products. I'm going to give you a description. You have $3 of buffer room with which to win a chocolate bar of your choice when I see you at a game. Now, okay. Nate Hobbs of the Mississauga Warriors quarterback, he was on last week and he completed the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire challenge. I threw some softballs at him, so I decided to change it up and go a little bit harder on you because I know you're a smart guy because I've seen some clips of you playing. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, your first item of three, Kraft Singles, 16 slices of cheesy processed goodness designed to fill you up while having fun on burgers, sandwiches, and anything you want to destroy the original taste of. What do you think the price of 16 Kraft Singles are? Now, I have to point out too, Matt, before you do this, these items are on sale because I went to the Metro Flyer this morning and picked out whatever I could that I thought you might know.
Oh, okay.
So what do you think 16 Kraft Singles are going for these days?
Now, is that 16 packages or 16?
No, this is 16 slices. 16 slices of cheesy goodness.
Oh, my. Ooh.
It's a 16 pack. It's the one that's bundled up. It's got the 8 on each side. Do you like Kraft Singles?
No, I'm not a fan.
Yeah, I loved them when I was a kid, and I've grown far, far away from them now. Are you kind of the same?
Yeah.
Yeah, they were the best thing going on burgers when you were a kid.
Oh, yeah, of course.
What do you think?
Gosh. I'm going to have to stab at the dark here.
Yeah.
So just a package?
Yep, single package.
$7?
$7. Okay, we'll wait until the end to give you the price.
Did I miss it by a bit?
Just a little. That's okay. That's all good. Maybe the food is more expensive due to the travel costs in Eastern Ontario. That might be why it's more difficult to have a OVFL franchise in the eastern end of the province. Just the travel cost. That's what it is. Okay, number two, sockeye salmon. Are you a salmon guy? Are you a tuna guy? Do you enjoy your fish?
I like. Yes, I do enjoy salmon, but I don't purchase it myself.
Yes, that's okay. We're not of age where we have to worry about it too much to go out and buy our own high-end fish meals. Sockeye salmon by Gold Seal. This single can of salmon contains 26 grams of protein and 3 grams of fat. For the fisherman and all of his friends, choose sockeye salmon to get your fushy goodness this Canada Day. What do you think the price of a single can of sockeye salmon is? It's the one you could literally hold in your hand. It's like a tuna can.
$5.50.
Okay, we'll go with $5.50 here. That is your guess for the sockeye salmon by Gold Seal. All right, now we have our third and last one. Decadent strawberry cheesecake. Have you ever seen the cakes in the bakery at Metro? The ones that are at the back where you walk past them and you really want them, but you're not sure you should buy them? This is the one that has about 15 different strawberries on the top of it. Topped with 16 fresh-cut strawberries prepared on-site and glazed in lemon coconut crust flakes. This 9-inch wide cake will be sure to fill you up and the entire family. What do you think the price of a cake is at Metro with a bunch of strawberries on top? It's all decadent. It's all nice. What do you got?
I'm going to have to go with $20.
Go with $20. Okay. Man, high-end living. High-end living. All right, now it's time to break down your results, okay?
Sure.
Hang with me here. Believe it or not, Kraft Singles are $2.99, which might be why we stopped eating them. Because as as cheap as they are in price, they taste as cheap as they are, don't they, Matt?
Yeah, I know.
That's all good. So you said $7. So on the first one, that's why I was laughing with you.
I was off quite a bit then, I guess.
That's all good. Like I said, it's the transportation cost. I don't know. Maybe you shop at a Fortino's or a Loblaws. Food prices are different, okay?
Loblaws, yeah.
You're a Loblaws guy. See, I'm a Metro guy, so I just go for everything that's on sale. If it doesn't have a sale price on it, I'm not going to buy it. Sockeye Salmon by Gold Seal. It's $2.99 as well. You said $5.50. I think you were looking at caviar. I think that's what you were thinking.
Probably.
That's okay. And the cake from Metro that I pointed out, the strawberry cheesecake, decadent coconut lemon goodness, is $12.99. Now it is on sale though from $18. So I'll give you credit for that one. You were within $2 of the cake to finish that last one, which I got to give you credit for, because I threw some hard ones at you, and I got to admit, trying to figure out prices of stuff, maybe I should have just gone with, like, your favorite food. What's your favorite food?
I can't really put it down to anything. I like seafood.
Seafood? Seafood, really, eh?
Yeah.
Would you take seafood over, like, a chicken or a steak? Are you one of those guys?
Why not both at the same time?
Hey, there it is. Nice. All right, well, that is the end of The Price is Right. Matt, congratulations on a fantastic week and a fantastic season. I haven't been able to reach out to you. I talked to you a couple of weeks ago. I was hoping to have you on. I'm glad I did get you on because it's been fun to watch so far. And I've been enjoying the Myers interaction on Twitter as well. Your team is fantastic at reaching out to OVFL Live on Twitter. It's been fun. Thanks for joining us, man.
No problem. Thank you for having me.
Best of luck. That is Mr. Matt Duffy, the Ottawa Myers Riders varsity quarterback. And wish him all the best moving forward in the season. Now, I wanted to play a quick clip from Mr. Mike Golick, who is he played 9 years in the NFL, playing career for the Houston Oilers, Philadelphia Eagles, and Miami Dolphins. He's the host of Mike and Mike in the Morning, a hugely successful and popular morning show on ESPN Radio, weekdays 6 to 10 a.m. He was in Hamilton a couple of weeks ago to watch his son attempt to make the Montreal Alouettes offensive line, and I spoke with him in an interview that I'll play for you right now.
All right, here with Mike and Mike, Mike Golick. Is this your first time ever being up and watching a CFL game? Is it because of your son?
It is, yeah. Now, my father played in the CFL years ago. He played for actually Montreal, Hamilton, and Saskatchewan. So it's interesting how it comes full circle here, yeah, with my son. This is my first time watching it live, yes.
And you're obviously pretty familiar with the CFL game through your coverage with ESPN and also, like you said, affiliation with your father playing up here then.
Well, I mean, yeah, my father was up here way before I was ever born, but I mean, I certainly know the game. Yes, certainly we cover it at ESPN and with all that. So we know the game. It's certainly a little different than what my son Mike's used to, but he's an offensive lineman, so there's not a whole lot different on an O-line.
Yeah, and obviously playing in Notre Dame, you did, he did as well, coming up here. What's the biggest difference that he's kind of talked to you about with playing in the Canadian game and what has he most enjoyed so far?
Well, I mean, again, as an old lineman, there's not a ton of differences. I mean, the one down less.
Yeah.
You know, he has to remember if they have to punt or run off the field and not realize it's third down in American football, where third down is really fourth down to what he has been used to. But other than that, O-line play is O-line play. So certainly there's a difference the farther you get away from the ball with the specialists, with the wide receivers and such, and 12 on the field and all that. But like anything else, you do it long enough and you get used to it. So, listen, it's football, so he enjoys it.
Absolutely. Football is football. Did you ever play a game that was as small as this stadium for a professional game in your career?
For a professional game? No. No, never here. Not even in preseason. I mean, we played a couple of games in London at Wembley when I was playing, but so out of what a normal NFL stadium would be, but nothing this size. But it doesn't matter. You know what the dimensions are, what they're supposed to be. So let's play football.
Looking forward at your son's chances of making the team, enjoying some time up here and getting acquainted in the CFL.
Well, I mean, certainly, you know, if right now it hasn't worked out for him in the NFL, he can give that a try, you know, in a couple of years. But until then, he'd love to be here and play. And he can play center, he can play guard, he can play tackle, so he can play all the positions. So he's versatile enough to help wherever they need. And now whatever's going to get him on the field, that's what he's willing to do.
Mike Golick joining us here on Max Marauders. Thanks so much.
You got it. No problem.
That was Mike Golick of ESPN, Mike and Mike in the Morning. And when I went up to talk to him, because he came to the game, and I'm like, I think that's Mike Golick. I should probably go see if I can talk to him for a second. And then I walked up to him and said, hey, are you Mike Golick? He goes, yeah. I'm like, any chance I can talk to you for a second? He's like, yeah. Yeah, it's fine. And he was super nice after that, but I could kind of tell I felt bad trying to ask him if he wanted to talk to me after. One person I don't feel bad asking if he'd like to talk to me is Tyler Crapigna. Tyler, are you there?
Yes, I am here.
Hey, there he is. Now, this is a bit of bias, but I am inducting my my teammate, Tyler Crapigna, into the OVFL Wall of Fame. Congratulations, Tyler. I know it's a big deal.
Thank you very much. I'm honored.
Were you shocked when I texted you this morning and said you're going in the greatest Wall of Fame in all of Canada?
I don't know, man. I was kind of just shocked to get the phone call and to get on the interview here. I know I've been watching the podcast lately, but I think I was going to have the chance.
Yeah, you were shocked and elated. You probably woke up and started running around your house and screaming, and your parents were freaking out.
It was Christmas morning all over again.
Okay, Tyler, now I didn't have the ability to pull up some of your stats. I was trying to give people some background because I think a lot of people know you as that little guy who happened to kick the Vanier Cup winning field goal, but there's a lot more to you. The season that you had in 2012 after that Vanier Cup run, you didn't miss a kick, I believe, off the top of my head. Am I correct in saying that?
Yeah, you are correct.
And how many field goals was it?
If I remember correctly, I think it was 18 for 18.
That's amazing. That's something I don't know if that'll be matched in the next while, because there's so many variables in the kicking game, right? It's difficult to reproduce that kind of success.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's not just me when it comes to the kicking game. You know, you still need the snapper and pinner, and, you know, and of course, what matters the most is that you got a good line up there blocking for you. So, I mean, it's not just the kick for me. It's all those guys that helped me out, and that's part of the reason why I went 18 for 18 that year with them.
Yeah, absolutely. I held field goals for you in practice for about three practices, I think, in 2011. And because I was the backup quarterback and they kind of needed me to do something more than hold a clipboard and wear a backwards hat and try and look cool. So they asked me to try and hold field goals for you. And I think I held for like 2 days. And then Coach Patasek here at McMaster was just like, yeah, no, just stop.
Yeah, no, I mean, I remember you showing me a clip from your high school days.
Actually, that's funny you bring that up. I should try and find that clip and put it out on the OVFL Live Twitter. There's a clip when I played for the Kingston Grenadiers, but the Limestone Grenadiers. And Tyler and I actually played in the same year in the OVFL, which is kind of cool to look back on as well. I was asked to be the holder for like two games because our guy was the regular holder. I'd hurt his shoulder, I think. And the field at Loyalist Collegiate Vocational Institute in Kingston, LCVI, was very muddy and very gross. It had like poured all night, and it's a grass field. And we got there in the morning, and it just had huge puddles everywhere. And one of the puddles happened to be pretty much right where the extra point was kicked from. So I threw a touchdown for the Grenadiers, probably one of the three touchdowns I threw in 8 weeks, and succinctly took the snap on the extra point and put it down. And I was so inexperienced. I had literally never held in practice before because it was sprung on me last second that I sat the ball down in the mud with two hands and then just took my hands off. And I remember showing you that clip and you just losing your mind going, what the hell are you doing?
Well, like I was looking, I was like, oh my God, I'm like, this is what's going to be happening within the next couple of weeks here at training camp. So
if I could plant the ball in turf, I think that'd be way more impressive than what I did at LCVI though. Agreed?
Oh, yeah, no, 100%. That'd be crazy.
you had an 85-yard kickoff in 2009 versus Brampton. What the hell happened on that kickoff? Were you guys backed up from penalties on the extra point, or what was going on? Because I saw the OVFL record for longest kickoff, and it's you at 85.
I'm actually not too sure, but I could probably attribute most of that to that AstroTurf at Minto Field.
Yeah.
The one field that no one ever wants to play on, and that ball, just as soon as it hits the ground there, it just bounces and it's gone.
The one season that I did play in the OVFL, our first game was at Minto, and I played against you, Sam Sabrin, Connor Williams, and that fantastic Myers team of those days. I believe it was 2007 or 2008. And I remember just like getting out and looking at the turf and going, what is this? Because I'd never seen AstroTurf like that. Did that help you kicking when you were going through the OVFL growing up in the Ottawa system?
Yeah, I mean, it was always good to just be able to kick on it. As bad as that turf was, it's always good to be able to kick on turf, you know what I mean?
Like, right.
Any type of variables that you can try and reduce, especially in the kicking game, you know what I mean? You can't really adjust, or you can adjust to weather, but you can't really control the weather and everything. So
right.
If you can take out grass and slipping on grass and wet, muddy fields and stuff like that and have an actual clean surface to kick off of, it's always better.
Absolutely. And you had for people that don't know, you hold a couple of other OVFL records, 7 attempted field goals in a game against Pickering. Were you just hell for Pickering? Like, just had 7 attempted field goals and 5 made in that game. And you also hold the record for the most field goals in a season at 17. Every time that a team you're on drives down the field and stops on second and long, gets stopped at about the 15-yard line, how thankful are you, Tyler?
Oh, I love it. I mean, I'd love for us to score a touchdown, I think, but I mean, like, let's be honest here. How many plays do I honestly get onto the field for the whole game? Maybe like 3 or 4. So if I can get any chance I can, I'm loving it.
It is kind of an interesting dynamic that I hadn't thought of until right now. The fact that your statistics, although I know you're not a guy that's obsessed with your own stats and all of this sort of stuff, but your own well-being and your own personal promotion pretty much relies on the offense being extremely successful and then not successful at all.
Yeah, no, it's kind of a two-sided sword, you know what I mean? Like, you want them to do well, but at the same time, like, well, I also want them to stall at some point, so at least I can get on the field and do something with my life here during the game.
Yeah, but there are kickers that are in the NFL Hall of Fame and some different rings of honor and stuff around the NFL that are pretty much leading their team's all-time scoring list based on extra points, which is insane, right? But if you think about it, if you last like a Gary Anderson, a Morton Anderson, a Vinatieri, if you last for a long time in the NFL, receivers, running backs, quarterbacks, for the most part, they come and go. If kickers can last, you end up, you know, being the tortoise and the hare, and you end up catching up in terms of all-time scoring, don't you?
Yeah, no, I mean, that's what it's all about for kicking wise. It's all about longevity. You know what I mean? Like, those kickers are usually the ones that are staying around the longest in the league because it's probably a less physical, you know, like, kind of game for them. And that's kind of one of the reasons why you get so many points and you're allowed to be in those positions.
Who is your all-time favorite NFL, CFL, anything kicker?
My favorite's got to be Vinatieri.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, just growing up and seeing like him, like, you know, and the Super Bowls of the Patriots, and when I was younger, especially the early 2000s, I mean, that's kind of when I was just kind of realizing that kicking was something that I wanted to do and pursue at a higher level. And I mean, that's kind of what I was watching, you know what I mean? Seeing this guy coming in these clutch situations, overtime, game winning kicks and stuff. Like, there's really not much more you can get better than being in those positions. And that's kind of something that I wanted to strive to be in those positions and be relied upon like that by a team.
I hate to ask you about the Vanier Cup because I'm sure you get it every time you turn around and somebody asks you about it, but in terms of looking at Vinatieri and how he kind of built his name and he became renowned with the idea of having ice in the veins and being successful in all of these things, how amazing is it when you're looking back on your university career now to realize that you hit one of those, you know, famous end-of-game field goals to win a national championship for your school?
I mean, it feels amazing. I mean, you kind of overlook the whole thing, like, once you actually won it, you know what I mean? You get caught up in the moment, and you don't really realize, like, what you just did. And I know one thing Coach P kind of always reiterated to us was that, you know, you're going to look back on this, like, in years from now, 20 years from now, at the reunion and everything, like, you know, and realize, like, what special group of guys you had to be with and to be a part of a team like that. I mean, and to do something like that in a game like that, it's something obviously you'll never forget, and I'm sure you'll be able to appreciate it more and more as time passes on.
Yeah, my honest opinion is that we were so naive because we were only second year players at that point that we didn't know what kind of pressure or what the implications of what we were doing were, right? Like, I didn't play a huge role. I was the backup quarterback. Yeah, I won 3 games. It was against some teams that maybe weren't so great that year, but looking at it kind of long term, you don't realize because you're so young and dumb that the impact you're having on the game, on a country, and on an entire school's alumni force, it's amazing to look back at it now and realize what that pressure was.
Yeah, no, and you know what I mean? Like, us going into that game and doing something like that, I feel like it really promoted a lot for the CIS. I mean, like, people kind of realized, like, during that game, okay, like, this quality of football here, it's for real, you know what I mean? These guys are actually good players, and this is good football, and this is kind of like this is what we're going to be seeing. A lot of these guys, we're going to be seeing them at the next level in the CFL in a couple of years, you know, and so that was definitely good for us to put on a good show like that, especially on national television.
It really did change the dynamic of CIS football for about a year and a half when we had that great team going. I want to ask you, what do you remember the most about your OVFL playing days? What is something that, when you think about your start in football and kind of how you got your beginnings long before you were hitting game-winning field goals in front of thousands and thousands of people, what do you remember most about playing for Myers and enjoying your time in the OVFL?
It was a good group of guys that we had on that team. You know what I mean? Like, you list off a couple of guys that you just said, like Connor Williams, Sam Sabran. Like, a lot of these guys went on to have very good collegiate careers. And you know what I mean? Like, just being able to play with guys of that quality, you know what I mean, at such a young age, and be able to kind of grow with them throughout the whole junior OVFL and then to the senior OVFL. Like, it's stuff like that that really made playing football like that much. But I mean, you want to play football because you like playing football and because you want to win, you know what I mean? And to be on a team like that, I mean, I couldn't ask for anything more. It was a great, great bunch of guys, and it was always great. It was always having good times on road trips and stuff. And that's kind of what it's all about. It's not just about the football itself. It's kind of about everything that comes along with it as well.
And you've moved on now and have gone through the CFL draft process, and we'll get to that in a second, but is that something you kind of want to hang on to and try not to forget as you, you know, really grow up in the sport and get to the point where you're playing professionally now, is the fact that when it all began, what it was all about, and the days that you most enjoyed were being with those guys?
Yeah, no, that's obviously one thing you never want to forget. I mean, no matter where you go, you kind of always want to remember where you started and who you grew up playing with and all that kind of stuff. That kind of, I feel like, kind of gets a little bit lost once money starts talking, you know. Yeah. What I mean? You're getting paid to play football. I mean, that stuff kind of gets put on the back burner. I mean, but that's originally what started you playing football. I mean, you should try and remember that for a good reason.
Yeah. How many incentives did you demand in your contract, Tyler?
To be quite honest with you, man, I didn't demand anything. I was just like, you know what, like, give me the contract, let me sign. I'm just ready to play football. That's all I want to do is just get a shot. Him.
No, you didn't. You sat down in the office and went, hey, Huff, get over here. Ripped into Huffnagel and demanded, listen, for every field goal I make, I'm getting a $50 bottle of something sitting in my locker. That's what you said.
Yeah. No, you know what? Like, I didn't even need to make that incentive demands. I mean, a lot of the older guys on the team kind of took me under their wing, and I didn't really have to pay for much while I was there. They paid for a lot of the stuff. So,
well, yeah, Tyler, when you're hitting a game-winning field goal in the preseason, the team's going to fall in love with you immediately, right?
Yeah, and it's funny. You know what? The funny thing is that it doesn't matter where I go. I always seem to have the nickname Rudy stick with me wherever I go. Like, and it doesn't matter. Like, it started in the OVFL. Like, not so much in collegiate, but like it suddenly just came back again. Like, I remember Fred Bennett actually said to me, he's just like, man, he's like, you're Rudy. He's like, you're definitely Rudy. And he asked my name for the first time. He's like, I was like, oh, like just a little like scared boy, pretty much. Yeah. Physical. Tyler, and he's like, no, he's like, your name's Rudy. And he's like, yeah. I'm calling you now on. And it kind of just stuck with me throughout the whole training camp.
Imagine he was just like, hey, you're going to be Rudy, okay? Like, what's your real name, man? You're like, Rudy. Obviously, Fred.
Yeah.
Do you think your shoulder has anything to do with that nickname?
I'm not sure. No, they didn't even really know about that. A lot of the guys saw the Vanny Cup tattoo, and
oh yeah,
they said something about that. I mean, it's like you said when you said to me before there. You know, like, I'm sure you get asked about this all the time whenever you turn around and everything, but like, even American guys were asking about that stuff, and I didn't even know they even really paid attention or even cared about CIS football, to be honest. So
yeah, it's cool. Some of the CFL guys that have been up in the league for a couple of years, they seem to be very in tune with the CFL. For those that don't know, Tyler, when you were in your first year, I was around for it. It was brutal. You suffered a broken leg against Guelph in a game at home at McMaster, and I don't think a lot of people realize how tough it was to come back from that for you, but I don't want to focus on the bad side. I want to talk to you about, do you think that ended up making you appreciate the gift of football and the joy of kicking more after you went through that experience?
Yeah, no, I couldn't put it better myself when you just said right there. I mean, being injured, and that was kind of the first time that I was actually really injured. You know what I mean? Like, I probably had maybe a couple like hamstring pulls here right. And there, but like nothing too serious. And I was, as a kicker, I definitely thought that I would never be on the field with a broken leg, especially at the position with all the rules to protect me and yeah. This and that throughout the league. But I mean, that kind of made me realize, like, you know what I mean, that I worked this hard to get to this point, you know, and that you can't really take anything for granted, and you just got to keep working at what you do, and eventually, you know what I mean, success will come from that. And if it doesn't happen immediately, it will happen eventually. And it obviously didn't happen immediately because I broke my leg, but I appreciated what all that whole process, and I came back from that better than ever. So I'm thankful for that happened.
To put it in perspective for people too, it was 2010 when you broke the leg. It was the fall of 2010. 2011, you were back kicking. 2012, you went 18 for 18, like we just talked about. So that kind of that shows the path back that you had. What is your favorite Vanier Cup memory that wasn't the kick? Because all people want to ask you about is the kick, like idiots like me did 2 minutes ago. So what is your favorite memory that doesn't involve that game-winning kick when somebody says, oh, what's your favorite memory? What was it?
You know what? I don't know if it was like, it wasn't like a huge thing that happened, but like I remember after I missed that kick, and I remember when I came off on the sidelines and cameras were in my face and everything, and I remember specifically Dallin Brooks came up to me, and you know what I mean? Like, took a knee right beside me, said everything was going to be fine, like, don't worry about it, we're going to need you again. And he was the one actually was, like, trying to block out, like, the cameras from, like, actually aping me and stuff like that, you know what I mean? And that, as no matter where I go, that kind of sticks with me as, like, you know, like, this was, like, really that team of ours was actually, like, a team, you know what I mean? Like, every guy stuck with each other. And it doesn't seem like it was a big thing at the time or now, but that meant the most to me. I'm not trying to be all soft here.
That
was definitely something that I remember.
Like for me, when you talk about being soft, you want to hear soft. When I played those three games for Kyle Quinlan when he was suspended in 2011, the game that we had at Windsor, the first time that we played a game without Kyle in like 2 years, after the game, I saw him in the stands. I didn't even realize he was going to be at the game. And I went over and saw him, and we just kind of like embraced, looked at each other, and I was just like, man, like, get back kind of thing. I was like, the team needs you. Like, I'm just here to sub in for a couple of games kind of thing. And it's that same kind of moment where it might not seem that huge and it's not shown on TV, but that's one of the things that sticks with you forever, right? It's just the interactions with the guys, like you're talking about playing in the OVFL, being with a great group of guys and what it means to you long term.
Yeah, no, and that's exactly what I mean. Like, it was the team that we had that year that kind of made everything so special, like going through everything, the road trips and all that stuff, going from coast to coast basically across the country in a matter of 2 weeks. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you can't ask for a better group of guys to do that with than that team. And I think that honestly, that those 2 weeks before kind of brought us the closest we've ever been, and especially leading up into the most important game that was much needed.
Yeah. The good luck when we're 30, trying to get 60 of your best friends to touch the Atlantic and the Pacific Ocean within a week, all together flying back and forth with each other.
Yeah, that's definitely not happening.
No. We'll all be a little bit busy and probably have some children. So the combine and the draft experience, I want to get you out of here because you've been very gracious with your time, but combine and draft, the team that I talked to you before the draft, and I said, what team do you least expect to go to? We were just in the locker room and I said, who have you talked to and all this stuff? And you said, I don't think Calgary's going to look at me. Like, they're pretty set. They have Rennie Paradis and Rob Maver, and they're really not going to need me. And then look who ends up taking you, right? Is that the surprise of the CFL draft? Is that kind of the nature of it? And how much have you enjoyed being out in Calgary for training camp when you were there?
Yeah, and, you know what I mean, to start off, like, that was a complete surprise. I mean, I didn't expect that at all. You know what I mean, you got two CFL All-Stars at their respective positions here. Like, I really didn't think. I was like, what would be the point? What would be the interest in them of drafting another kicker? You know what I mean? Unless it's to develop me for years to come, because I really don't see anyone trying to displace Rennie Paradis. That guy, I've had the chance to play with him in training camp now, and that guy just doesn't miss. It doesn't matter if it's game time or if it's in practice, he just doesn't miss.
So. El Matador, as he's known across the CFL.
Yeah, it's a great group of guys, though. You know what I mean? I love being out there for that month of June there. It was just amazing. You know, the guys were really supportive, and, you know, it's kind of intimidating, especially coming into your first professional training camp. You know what I mean? Like, you don't really know. You're kind of trying to get the lay of the land, you know, like, especially for me, I've only been across that side of the west of the country, you know what I mean? Only once before in the Vanny. So being there again and actually setting up permanent residence there for a bit, like, kind of was a little bit intimidating. But, I mean, like I said before, the guys really took me in, and it was just a great experience being out there. And, you know what I mean? Like, I had a feeling that the better you did at camp, the more that they would come and respect you. Because, to be quite honest, I mean, a lot of people probably look at me like, who is this little 5'3" kid? You know what I mean?
You're Rudy.
Yeah, exactly. So, like, you know, just being there and having the great group of guys kind of bring me in just made me a lot more comfortable and allowed me to kind of do what I usually do there at the professional level.
What was it like being back in res at UFC?
It was fun. It was fun. In the thing that I picked up the most from this training camp was that it was like the group of guys that we had, like when I played OVFL football, like
right.
when I was 13, 14 years old, it was like the exact same group of guys. Like they still want to play like PlayStation. They still want to play FIFA and all that stuff.
Yeah.
Like that's all we were doing. And these guys are like 28, 29 years old, you know what I mean? So it's like we're still kids, just still playing the game that we love, you know what I mean? But now we're just getting paid to do it, so.
Yeah, when I...
It's funny to see that.
Again, I don't want to tell a story about myself, but you're just reminding me of being in res with the Stamps last year when I was there for training camp. And we were in the res and we were watching Game 6 of Pacers and Heat in the Eastern Conference Final. And there was two rooms the guys were watching in, and I just kind of walked into a room and sat down, like laid down in front of the TV in one of the common rooms, and was watching the game for a while. And Larry Taylor, the returner who's now in Montreal that was in Calgary, kind of came up to me when he walked in the room with some food, and he said, "Marshall, are you sure you want to be in here?" And I was like, "Yeah, why?" And he goes, "There's only brothers in here." And I turned around and I looked, and it was all the black guys, and they kind of looked at me, and they realized I was there, and they're like, "What are you doing here?" And I was like, "I'm just chilling, guys." And they're like, "Oh, that's my boy." Like they just fell in love with me all of a sudden, and were like obsessed with the fact that I was just down to watch. I'm like, "Yeah, guys, I'm okay with everybody. Relax. Like I'm here to watch the game with you. It's all good."
Yeah. Those guys were, I've never seen guys that play football more interested in another sport.
Yeah.
In basketball than I've ever seen before. Like they were just all about basketball. Like every day in the locker room, everyone was talking about the Heat and the Spurs this year. You know what I mean? Like everyone was just anticipating the next game. Like we're always watching on TV in the locker room and stuff. Like it was crazy.
How much smack did Juwan Simpson talk when people were chirping him about being from Alabama?
Oh yeah, he's that was pretty funny. He definitely sticks up for his school. I mean, he doesn't let anyone push them around, but I mean, he's able to talk smack because they're the best team in college football. So.
Yeah, it's exactly like, again, I'm saying, when I was there, he literally, guys would just be like, "Shut up, Juwan. Like, you don't know what you're talking about." And then he would just chase them down the hall in the res building and go like, "I don't even know what school you went to, and whatever you went to, I don't even know what the name of it is. It's like Southwest Savannah State. Like, get out of here."
Yeah, he's definitely high strung on being from Bama, but it's pretty funny to watch all those guys interact, especially from a lot of the bigger schools. I mean, they kind of still go at it, as you know what I mean, like we had Jock Sanders there, like he was always repping West Virginia stuff. Like,
oh yeah,
it was just, it's crazy how they still have that pride of their collegiate, even though they're at the pro level now. Like,
hey, well, you'll still have that too when you make it to the CFL. The pro life, I wanted to ask you, in baseball they have walk-up music. If you were to have walk-up music, doesn't have to be when you're going out for a game-winning field goal or anything like that, what would you want your walk-up music to be if you could choose a song for any specific moment in a game?
I don't know. I like to try and keep it low-key and funny, so I'd probably pick, I know this is weird as hell, but I'd probably pick like the Lollipop Field song from the
Yes. That's a great pick.
Yeah, I'd probably choose that, you know what I mean? Because everyone would just be laughing and everything and wouldn't actually be paying attention to the actual situation. The next day, you know, I'd come through in the situation, I'd be laughing in the end. So I think it would be pretty funny.
That's awesome. Dana Sagan is your kicking coach at McMaster. He played in the CFL as well a little bit. I got to wonder, a guy like you that enjoys football as much as you do, you obviously have a ton of playing left in you. But do you ever think about coaching and wanting to kind of bring up the next great Canadian kicker at some point during your experience in football?
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely something I definitely want to be doing, you know what I mean, later on after my career is said and done. But, I mean, it's always good to kind of give back, you know, and that's the one thing that I noticed growing up is that there's just not a lot of people that really pay attention and devote time to that whole kicking kind of aspect of the game. And, I mean, I know at the CFL level, I know that there's only really one guy that kind of deals with every CFL kicker no matter which team he's on, and I know it's Don Sweet, so
yeah,
you know what I mean, like when you only got one guy doing that and he's like, you know, I feel like every CFL team or every professional team or collegiate team, they should have one guy on their staff that is at least taking care of the kicking game, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
because especially in Canadian football, it's it's a huge part of the game, and I know you know that because you were a punter for several games during that Vanny Cup run.
Yeah, you decided to go kissing people, and I had to try and figure out how to punt as fast as I possibly could. Got mono on me.
Yeah, that was kind of threw you in that situation a little quick, but I mean,
that was fun.
Handled it well. So, and you know, I mean, if anything, it brought a little bit of perspective from your point of view, and
how big important, time.
You know what I mean? Like that third down is key, especially with all the fakes that we ran. That really is a kind of a game changer, especially a momentum changer as well.
Yeah, I'll say as long as I live that, you know, winning the Vanier, yeah, that's cool. You know, throwing touchdown passes in front of a couple thousand people at an OUA game, that's cool. I punted, man. Like, I felt bad because I was doing it for you, but obviously because you were unable to do it, I was like, okay, I'll step in and do it. And it's really fun when you do it right, isn't it?
Yeah, no, it definitely is. I mean, that's the fine line, though. It's exactly what you said there. It's really fun when you do it right, but when you do it wrong, it's one of the most frustrating things you can ever deal with in life.
So. And the weirdest thing is, too, when you're supposed to kick to the sideline and pin somebody in a corner for your coverage team, and you can shank it into the middle, which I did a bunch, and you just hack it over the middle, and as soon as the tackle happens, if it happens, thank God we have good coverage teams at McMaster, then the other 11 guys, as they're jogging back to the sideline, just stare at you like, the hell was that?
Yeah, no, and that's where you kind of just have to turn the other cheek to them, you know what I mean? Just kind of pretend like you're fixing your shoe or something, you know what I mean? So no one's looking at you or anything like that. It was all the shoe's fault.
You're schooled in the art of the shoe. That's good, Tyler.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining me. You might coach one day. You might do several other things involved in football because you've got a bright future. But as for right now, you're a fantastic kicker and a great interview. So thank you for joining me, buddy. And I'm sorry about Forza Azzurri at the World Cup.
Yeah, no, don't even bring that up, man. You had a great interview right now. I don't want to be bringing it up.
I'm sorry. I didn't mention it. Forget it. I didn't bring it up.
All right. Thanks a lot, Marshall.
Yeah, thanks, buddy. Talk to you soon. That was Tyler Crapigna of the McMaster Marauders family and currently possession of the Calgary Stampeders. They are very lucky to have their greasy hands all over Tyler. We've done a long interview. This is basically turning into the Ottawa Myers Riders podcast right now. We have interviewed Matt Duffy of the Varsity Riders, and now we just talked to Tyler, who goes into the Wall of Fame. Good to get a hold of him. Let's do a score recap, because we are running out of time, and I would like to get some scores all up in your face. All right. In varsity action this week, we had the Essex Ravens traveling to Hamilton, defeating the Ironmen 51-7 at Ron Joyce Stadium. It was 53-13 for the Cambridge Lions over the Mississauga Warriors in a game that surprised many people. A big showing by James Roberts and the Cambridge Lions over Nate Hobbs and Mississauga Warriors in that QB duel. 41-18 for the Niagara Spears as they continue to be a powerhouse in this end of the province. Kingston Grenadiers 42-0 in varsity play over the York Simcoe Buccaneers at Ray 20 Complex, which is up in York Simcoe there. The Grenadiers went on the road and got a big win. I saw Cornwall play Metro last week. I talked to their head coach, Kirby Champlin, and he said that he needed a big win out of his guys. He needed a great effort going into Oshawa in week 6. They got it. 48-19 was the final Cornwall over Oshawa in varsity play. Sault Ste. Marie travels down to London and defeats the Mustangs. Sault Ste. Marie, I don't understand how good they are on the road. It doesn't make sense to me. You have to travel so far for every game. They came to Hamilton, they won. Then they went to Essex and lost a tight game, and now they come down and beat London. That's a hell of a schedule, and they've done an excellent job fighting through. Again, I'm a real big fan of Sault Ste. Marie's coaching to have their kids focused in all of those games. Talk to Matt Duffy about his 45-7 win over the Toronto Thunder. That was a quality one. Game of the week, most likely. Cumberland 37, Pickering 34 in a close matchup at Kinsmen Park. 46-14 for the Metro Toronto Wildcats. They have a pretty explosive offense as well, and they showed it against Markham. Markham's struggling a bit right now. Saw them in week 1 against Cornwall when they got beat up a little bit, but hoping that Markham can turn around towards the end of the season. Halton gets blanked by Brampton. Kyle Gouvet and the Brampton Bulldogs at Jean Vanier Catholic High School in Halton fall to the Brampton Bulldogs 35-0. JVs, 34-18 Niagara Spears, 24-14 for the Hamilton Ironmen over the Essex Ravens. That was a big one because Essex is a pretty talented JV team, and Hamilton really proved themselves. Hamilton's only loss, I believe, to this point against the Brampton Bulldogs, and they have got some quality wins on their resume moving forward toward the playoffs, as we are only 2 weeks away from the playoffs. Crazy! 56-14 for the London Junior Mustangs over the Sault Ste. Marie Sabercats. There's the road issues that I thought would show up. They showed up in the JV game, not in the varsity. Ottawa Myers Riders 51-14 at Carleton University over the Toronto Thunder. Cumberland Panthers 50-7 over the Pickering Dolphins. The Metro Toronto Wildcats again defeated the Markham Raiders 30-6 in JV action, and Halton went 0-2, getting blanked in both games against the varsity and the JVs, 44-0 for the Brampton Bulldogs at Halton. York Simcoe Buccaneers 21-14 over the Kingston Grenadiers, and 41-21 in JV action for the Cambridge Lions against the Mississauga Warriors. Now on to the Bantams. 56 points for a Bantam team. Again, Essex, crazy. 56-28 was the final there at Bishop Ryan Secondary School as the Hamilton Ironmen were trying to recruit players for the Fall League, which is coming up. So if you'd like to register for the Fall OVFL season, check out OVFLOntario.com because there will be some things posted there. You can get your kids involved. London Junior Mustangs over the Niagara Spears in Bantam action, 40-35 at TD Waterhouse Stadium. A great score there. Again, a lot of points. Kingston Grenadiers Bantam squad, 43-7 over the York Simcoe Bucks. Cumberland Panthers over the Pickering Dolphins 39-20. Mississauga Warriors defeat the Halton Cowboys 37-26. And again, the Metro Toronto Wildcats explosive offense, even at the Bantam ranks, defeats the Markham Raiders 49-0. The Ottawa Myers Riders 37-19 in Bantam action over the Toronto Thunder. And finishing off our score recap from this week, 47-19 for the Brampton Bulldogs over the Cambridge Lions. That is your score recap. We only have a couple of minutes remaining here, so I'm going to skip over, we're going streaking, I'm going to skip over the power rankings because we will update those next week. What I wanted to get to was our OVFL Live Lineman of the Week, our Lineman of the Week.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright.
This week it is Colin Leseperance of the Essex Ravens. I was lucky enough to see Colin play against the Hamilton Ironmen.
Like a rock.
He was this past weekend. He had a fantastic game against the Ironmen. He was fun to watch. He's a real rock in the middle. He was eating up double teams all afternoon. And he definitely showed why he deserved to be a member of the Like a Rock family. And I wanted to play for you here a quick little clip. I actually got a chance to talk with Colin after the game. Here he is. Enjoy.
Here with OVFL Live Lineman Colin Leseperance. Colin, congratulations first of all on winning Lineman of the Week. I know it's a big honor for everyone throughout the league that they look forward to trying to get it. You were really fun to watch this evening for me. You had a couple of sacks. You were in the backfield causing havoc, and I know you guys were rotating through and subbing, but tell me a little bit about your game tonight.
I just like playing at the same intensity every game, coming out, just keeping the same intensity, keep rushing the passer, stopping the run. So it's my job. That's what I got to do. So,
do you consider yourself an all-around kind of guy, or are you more pride yourself on stopping the run, getting to the quarterback? What do you kind of define your game as?
No, I like being known as an all-around player. I can get to the quarterback. I can stop the run, make piles in the middle. I think I'm an all-around player for sure.
And who are some of your influences on the D-line linebackers? Who did you look up to growing up and some of your favorite players now in modern football?
Growing up, I would look at Warren Sapp. I like watching him. I like watching Jesse Williams from Alabama. He's on the Seahawks now. And I just looked up to a lot of those guys. And even some guys I played with high school.
Yep.
I used to look up to those guys, too. And I just want to make a good name for myself.
So. I noticed after you had one sack tonight that you got up and sprinted to the bench to get off the field. Was that an Alden Smith?
Yeah, exactly. An Alden Smith. Yeah, that's what I was trying to do.
That's awesome. That's a good one to have. What's it like playing for Coach Mills? I know he's a fiery guy. He's someone that demands the best out of his players every single snap. Do you enjoy playing for him, and what's that relationship like working under him?
No, he's a tough coach and all, but he runs a tight ship, and I like it. It's intensity at practice is always high, and then that's why we come over here and we play good games, and we have good games. I like playing for him. He's a very good coach, very good. A lot of respect for him.
And your goals moving forward through the rest of the OVFL regular season into the playoffs, what are you talking about at Essex in terms of the things you want to accomplish and what you want to get done for the rest of the season?
We want to win a championship, obviously, and we just want to go out, finish a good season, then go in the playoffs, have a good march in the playoffs, and we want to win a championship. That's plain and simple. That's what we want to do.
Yeah, it's always the goal.
That's the goal for sure.
And university. Who have you talked to? Where you're looking at going? Have you committed anywhere? And what are you doing for school?
I'm thinking about going to U of W. That's where I'm going to go. I talked to actually the school in Nova Scotia, Santa Fe.
Yep.
Talked to that school. And but I think I'm going to stay home. It's just too expensive to go away. So.
Yeah. Thanks, buddy.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot.
No worries.
The old stay-at-home move by Colin Leseperance, and the University of Windsor will be very happy to have him. He's a game-changer, and they can look forward to enjoying his services, hopefully, over the next couple of years. Now it's time to update our OVFL Live Grad Challenge. The OVFL Live Grad Challenge, we threw it out to OVFL players to see if we can get some pictures of them involved in their graduation ceremonies. Got a couple more in this week that I wanted to give a shout-out to. Darby Bradley of the Oshawa Hawkeyes, he sent in a fantastic picture of him in his blue robe. It's the first and only selfie which we've received in the grad challenge, so props for that, Darby. And it's actually a pretty good picture. I believe it's him and his buddy that both play on the Oshawa Hawkeyes, which was kind of fun to see two teammates graduating together, which they can play this song for years to come and remember their time together in the OVFL. Eric Martin of the Ottawa Myers Riders, he sent in a picture of his Wolf Tee cutoff and flip-flops, which is a solid look because he's standing next to four of his buddies, which happen to be wearing full tuxedo suits. What I really want to know is, what did Eric's date wear? Canadian tuxedo? Jorts and sandals? As much as I bash it, good on Eric for just being himself. People get too worried about looking nice anymore. Just do you, folks. But the winner of our OVFL Grad Challenge, and this is going to be a wrap on the Grad Challenge today, is John Rainbow Road Allaire. A magnificent piece of fashion with a whole lot of function tied in. John has this unbelievable suit, which we referenced in episode 4. He looks unreal, and I'm so glad he's sending the picture. Thank you to the Ottawa Myers Riders Twitter account for sending that picture in, or forcing John to send it in, because they knew how glorious it was before I had a chance to see it. So I'm very thankful that they sent that in. That is it for the grad challenge. Thank you to everybody who sent in pictures. That's really fun. It's nice interacting with you guys and having some fun stuff. I'm just going to leave this music on while I do winners and losers because it's amazing. Perfect background music for any setting. Doesn't matter. Winners and losers. Loser, Darcy Tucker for finally coming off the Toronto Maple Leafs payroll. As of tomorrow, July 1st, Canada Day, Darcy Tucker will no longer be getting paid by the Buds. He's a winner for getting paid for this long without playing for them. But man, that's going to bite when you're not getting the checks anymore. That's going to be a rough one. Honey, do you want to go out for dinner tonight? No, we can't. The Leafs stopped paying me. So that sucks for Darcy Tucker. Losers, people who smashed the Raptors draft pick this week on Twitter. I saw some people that were even OVFL players who were like, oh God, the Raptors do it again. Way to go, boys. That sucks. Raptors are going to suck next year. Well, you don't know who the guy is. If you don't know who he is, how can you smash him? Were Thunder fans pumped about hearing the name Serge Ibaka or Thabo Sefolosha when they were drafted? Probably not. They weren't well known. We're so focused on North American sporting culture, and this goes for the NFL as well. Name five guys for me that are from outside of North America that play in the NFL. It's not easy to do. But we're so focused on North American sporting culture, I think we have a superiority complex, and we forget that other nations play sports too, and they're damn good at it in some respects. Just look at the Olympics and even international basketball in that respect. Accept all. Give them a fair chance. Winner, Toronto for hosting World Pride. Speaking of accepting all and giving them a fair chance, awesome event preaching acceptance, unity, happiness for all. Total success in my books. Plus, the day ended with a huge rainbow over the city of Toronto, which is a very fitting end to Pride Day, and it's a message that needs to be sped throughout the OVFL as well, and something that we'll look at promoting through this show, because it is important for everyone to feel comfortable in their own skin. Winner, the Central Canada Women's Football League. They held a skills clinic at Trio Sportsplex in Vaughan. The Argos were there. Their jerseys were unveiled for their four teams. Premier Kathleen Wynne was there. It's exciting times for the CCWFL. We wish them all the best. We had them on the show last week. If you want to hear our interview with Nikki Allen of the CCWFL, you can check out episode 5 of OVFL Live, just posted on YouTube. Now it's time for birthdays. This song even works with birthdays. That's amazing. I'm not even mad. Miles Austin, receiver for the Cowboys. He turns 34 today. He's really fallen off since a monster game, 300 yards or so, I think it was, 3 or 4 years ago against Kansas City. But don't worry, you're 34 now, Miles, so I'm sure you're going to get more money in your next contract, because that's usually how it goes, right? No, that's not how it works. So Miles Austin is 34. Iron Mike Tyson today. Guess how old Iron Mike turns? 48. I can't think about Mike Tyson without playing this clip.
Come on.
Do we need a musical?
Hey! Shh! Don't make any sudden movements.
Who the hell are you?
No, who the hell are you?
Quiet, quiet.
Mike Tyson?
This is my favorite part coming up right now. I can feel it coming in the air tonight.
Of course, my guy.
But I've been waiting for this moment for all my life.
One more time, guy.
Oh, Lord.
That was Mike Tyson in Hangover. That was one of my favorite clips. Mike Tyson doesn't look a day over 60. Don't tell him that or he will break me. Michael Phelps of he of swimming and Subway fame, 33 world records, 22 gold medals, turns 29 today. He has 18 gold medals, 2 silver, 2 bronze. What, Michael Phelps? You couldn't turn the 2 silver, 2 bronze into golds? What's wrong with you? Couldn't get the full 22 gold? Hey, you slacking? Get out of the pool. Not having a good day, are you? You are 29 years old. Seems way older than 29 because he has accomplished more athletically in 29 years than any of us will in 89 years. And that is pretty much the show for today. Hope you enjoyed. I hope everybody has a fantastic time over their Canada Day weekend. I will be going to the Blue Jays game and seeing the Sheepdogs at Edgefest. Speaking of Canadian music, if you would like to listen to some quality Canadian music, you can every Friday morning here on CFMU 93.3, broadcasting out of Hamilton with Canadian Rush, a show hosted by Tom Sterling, who sometimes hosts on this show. It airs from 7 a.m. to 9 a.m., so listen to it on your morning commute, and have a fantastic Canada Day tomorrow. That will do it for us here from Hamilton. Week 7 is coming fast and furious. Hope everyone has a good week of practice leading up to it. For all of us here at OVFL Live, don't just have a great night, have a Canadian night. Have a good Canada Day, everybody.
And that will do it from St. Louis, where the score is inconclusive. Good night.
I'm your host, Toby, and this is the first segment of In No Particular Order. Each week on In No Particular Order, we'll explore the commonalities in the way that music makes us feel and the way that we relate to it.